Вот. Ну, по крайней мере, вы у меня все видны. Эдуард, хорошо. Я сейчас расскажу совсем не так, как на лекции, а по-другому. Так. Сейчас перейду на английский язык. So, I'd like to explain one of the main issues in modern mathematical physics. So my topic would be topic of this program to discuss what is quantum field theory, what is string theory, and in particular, how unification of two approaches to superstring, namely the approach coming from the B-twisted topological strings and Berkovich strings, could lead to some progress. But this will be at the very end. And we will start by trying to understand the main principles of modern view on quantum fields and strings. So today I'll discuss what I call Dirac, Siegel, quantum field theory. It's interesting that the answer is quite simple. The Dirac-Siegel quantum field theory is a function. So maybe you have heard different definitions, but there is such a definition as a functor. By the way, who knows what the functor is? I'll repeat such that everybody would understand. So first thing is a category. In category, we have something that is called objects. So it could be different kind of objects. It could be sets, it could be vector spaces, it could be groups, algebras, manifolds, many other. But category is either category of manifolds or category of sets or category of algebras, etc. And objects in this category is a set or the algebra or vector space. Okay, there is another thing that's called morphisms. So they are depicted as an arrow. So morphisms act from the object A to the object B. So this is a morphism. Okay. And there is an important notion of composition of morphisms. So suppose we have objects A, B, and C, and there is a morphism from A to B. Let me call it M1, and there is a morphism M2 from B to C. Then it's piece of the axiom that we can compose that. Sorry, first we do M1, and then we do M2. So it's composition of morphisms. So if the category is a category of sets, we can just compose maps. This composition should obey an important rule called associativity. Could be the same. As this one. So it's very natural axiom. So this is a category. And let me tell you what the functor is. Maybe it's not K. I think it's C here. So suppose you have objects A in one category and objects alpha in another category. Here object B and also object beta. So here is a morphism M and here is a morphism mu. So functor is something that takes objects to objects and morphism to morphism compatible with the composition. But this is not enough. It turns out this is not enough to define quantum field theory. In order to define quantum field theory, we have to say that we need not a typical category, but category with the tensor product or with the product. People used to say product. And what does it mean? It means that there is another operation. If you have objects A and B, you can make another object. That is called A. So the equation is how to call it. I will call it with a cross, AAB. And there is also corresponding operation on morphism. So to keep in mind, what is this, how this category can look like, we would first study the simplest category of this type. This is the category of vector spaces.
Is it direct product or it is some another kind of product? I don't understand.
What product?
In some categories there are direct products and direct sums.
No, it's another kind of product. Mm-hmm. Another kind of product. So example one, vector spaces. So vector spaces actually form a category. So we have vector space V1. Vector space V2, these are objects. And here we have M1 linear maps. or linear operators. It is clear that they form a category. And because we can compose them, and as a product, it's just a tensor product. Moreover, this product could be different. You see, we'll consider symmetric tensor product. Symmetric product. So, it is this category. And it's clear how morphisms are how to make a product of morphism. Actually, element from map M1 from V1 to V2, M1 actually belongs where? It belongs to V1 star times V2. So if I tensor this with M2, here I put U1 star times U2. And if I take, so M1 belongs here, M2 belongs here. So new object is tensor product of two objects is V1 times U1. Here we have V2 times U2. And the tensor product of morphisms, M1 tensor M2, is clearly defined as an element from V1 star, V2 star, U1 times U2. Sorry, so here I go V1 star, sorry, U1 star, sorry. Here is V2, U2. So it's basically clear how to make the tensor product of morphisms. So it's one category, it's example number one. Now we will define another category. So here is example two. It's category of comorphisms. So objects are d-dimensional manifolds oriented. The simplest thing is a product, disjoint union. Point, say A, point CB is the pair of points. And it's clear that this product is also should also be associative and all that. What is interesting is what is a morphism. So morphism between one manifold, I just put two components, x1 and x2, and another manifold, let it contain one component. Is a manifold that I will call sigma that has x and y as the two components of the boundary. And what is more important, or what's also important, that this cobordism may depend on something that I call G. G is geometrical data. So what is geometrical data? It could be Riemannian metric. It could be complex structure. It could be almost complex structure. It could be conformal class of metric. It could even be differential form. So everything that is a geometrical field. Now, so if these are morphisms, the question is, of course, what is the composition of morphisms? Suppose I have another morphism. So is it clear what is written here? Could you see? If you don't see, just let me know. We are in distant format, so I should somehow know that things are going properly. So let me call it sigma one. Let me call this one sigma two. And here I put geometrical data G1, and here I put geometrical data G2. And let me even put here a handle just to show that topology of this could be quite complicated. So composition just means that here I should have Y, and here I should have say Z1, Z2. So composition means that we are taking this one and gluing it here. So in this way, putting here sigma 2 G2, and here I need to have object Y with the opposite orientation. So one can choose orientation on the manifolds and also orientation on the cobordism. If they have opposite orientation, I can glue them together. And this is the composition. So the simplest The simplest example of such cobordism is the following. Suppose we have two intervals. And when we glue them together, we get an interval AC. Let us for a moment assume that as geometrical data will pick up metric. So in particular, this could have length T1, this length T2, and if we glue them together, this would have length T1 plus T2. And I just mark that it was just a point that was used in gluing. Okay, I call this length of the interval T intentionally. I just want to say that in physics, it would be like a time. Now, what does it mean now? What I will associate to things. I will associate to X vector space V of X. You may consider this V of X as a space of states in physics. We will see it. And now I am coming to the main object. And the main object is what I associate to a morphism. This is so important that I will write it in red. So functor would take this guy and associate to it object that I will call I, that depends on sigma 1, G1, and it belongs in the maps. So since it takes X1, X2, it belongs to, maybe I can either write it, it's a homomorphism from V of X1 times V of X2 into V of Y. And since it depends on geometrical data, it's not just homomorphism. It takes values in the space of functions on geometrical data that I call geom. In this particular example, I of the interval AB with the length T belongs where? It belongs hom VA VB times function on R plus. So in this simple example where I may consider points as the same point, in the sense that I may consider that VA is isomorphic to VB. This thing is nothing but, they call it V. This thing belongs to endomorphisms of V times function on R class, and I will denote it as I of T. So these guys are higher dimensional generalizations of such notion. Now, what the world functor means? The world functor means that if you make composition of morphism, that composition comes into composition. So this composition here should go to composition of endomorphisms. And making long story short, okay, I'll erase this nice picture, because I'll replace nice picture by the formula that is even nicer. I of T2 plus T1 equals I of T2 composed with I of T1. So here composition is taken as elements of endomorphisms. So it means that I just compose them as linear operators. So this condition has a simple solution, up to some subtleties that I'll omit. It means that I of T is this. So now about naming. I call it I because this I should replace functional integral. Because I would like to say that functional integral is only an asymptotics of this in the semi-classical limit. And this is a complete quantum formula. Of course, you know this formula. So you used to know it in this form. It is an evolution operator in quantum mechanics. Here, there is no I, no condition on H to be Hermitian or anti-Hermitian, and what is more important, no Planck constant. So having no Planck constant is actually a discovery that was made by Paul Dirac in interpretation of John von Neumann. So there is a beautiful book, John von Neumann, Mathematical Foundations of Quantum Mechanics, where on the question of what is quantum mechanics, John von Neumann said, it's very simple. You have vector space and you have this type of evolution. That's it. That's dynamics. And the rest is just measurements. That is a special theory. absence of h bar means that this thing knows nothing about classical limits. You may say that h bar equals to one, however, in this form, it is meaningless. From these axioms, it is clear that there is no h bar. Moreover, let me tell you that in this formulation, in this system of axioms, not only there is no h bar, there is no notion of fields. You see? It's very interesting. I am trying to tell you that the quantum theory, that the quantum field theory does not contain fields, does not contain Planck constant. That's why you may think that it is quite unusual formulation of quantum field theory. So later on, I'll try to convince you that not only this thing generalizes Feynman integral approach, even in quantum field theory, but that this is deeper because many systems just do not have H bar inside them. Okay? In order to convince you, let me give an example. So since you seem to have a physical background, am I right? So let me see. Okay, Olga, I think you should have physical background since you came from Alexei. Okay? So all of you know what is the rotation of the spin in the magnetic field. It's a very simple system. You have C square okay, so may I erase this? So spin quantum mechanics, V is C square, H is sigma 3, you see what I know. So what I have here, I definitely have a spin rotation. So you may ask, what about Planck constant? If I have such system, I cannot say that there is any Planck constant. What about the action? No action. What about fields? You may say that you can find this system if you study quantum field theory with a target space equal to S2. But how to find S2 in such simple data? So when you have a spin of electron, where do you see S2? You will not see S2. You see? You cannot touch that. You cannot touch it. You cannot detect it. So this is internal quantum definition of quantum field theory. So And this, you see, what's important. So why I cannot just write things like this? Because I want the generalization from quantum mechanics to quantum field theory. And this notion of functor gives exactly this generalization. So I'd like to postpone higher things for the talk that I will give on Wednesday. So by the way, lectures are on Wednesday. And they will be available on the internet. You see, before I proceed, I'd like to listen to questions. There should be some questions. You see, I'm a bit surprised not having questions. Because you see, I told you about functor, functor associated with geometrical data, etc. So it's not a standard thing that you have used in physics. So I don't know if you take up some book like Weinberg, or if you take more refined book, like, I don't know, it was called, I thought, Princeton Course of Theoretical Physics or Mathematical Physics for Mathematicians. You will not see there such definition. You see, I don't have a book right now to show you that. But it is not there, but you may trust me. One second. Okay, you see, in this book you will never find it. You see, I am acting a bit like a person who is selling you an idea that you will not buy it in this shop, okay? So you can probably get it here for free, okay? Looks as if I'm trying to give you some garbage, but still, it's not a garbage, it's very deep. Now, I want to tell you something even deeper. I'm sorry, but I'm trying to tell you something, and I actually want you to understand me so you have a possibility not to read, not to watch a talk. You have a unique possibility to ask questions. That's why I'm here. I'm really trying to explain to you these ideas so you could follow this. So now I want to tell you how this could be generalized to so-called higher, I call it this way, topological quantum field theory. You may ask, why do we need this higher topological quantum field theory when we already have axioms for quantum field theory? So there are two reasons for this. First reason is very pragmatic. So if you heard about string theory, then in string theory, so how to write it? You might be heard about such things called string amplitudes. So these string amplitudes that people depict like this could be understood in a proper way only in this framework. So in order to construct such amplitude, you need to have higher topological quantum field theory on two-dimensional surface equipped with a geometrical data being moduli space of complex structures. And it was Edward Witten, I think it's 93. Who wrote a paper. You see, Witten has a habit, strange habit, to write papers. This paper was called Chern-Simons as string field theory. Well, when he started the idea that there is something that should be called universal string. Universal string is a construction such that known at that moment string theories were just different representations of this universal string theory. And then people elaborated this idea a bit and found that there are different string theories, not as people used to say, 2A string, 2B string, heterotic string. No, in a very different sense. There are so-called topological type A strings, topological type B strings, superstring, Berkowitz string. So these are different representations of the idea of universal string theory that was put by Witten in this year, 27 years ago. And all this happened for strings, so for objects that have space dimension one and space time dimension two. However, this concept works in any dimension. So it works in dimension one, where situations are simpler than in string theory. It works also in higher dimension, where situation is more complicated. So this object is more universal than even Witten's universal string theory. So it's one reason. And the second reason has a mathematical interpretation. So in mathematics, people used to speak in maximal generality. Okay? So it's a habit of mathematicians. So they never say, let us consider the group SU2 only. Mathematicians used to say, consider the Lie group. Or at least consider the Lie group SUN. But they rarely start by considering the group SU2. They work with in some generality. So let me give you provocative question. Maybe you will guess. When I say that I have that the main object, sorry, I of sigma g belongs to home Vx to Vy times functions on GOM, where do I have parameter here? So mathematicians want to get rid of parameters. Where do I have parameter? And what is the parameter that I'll try to generalize? So the hint here in this description, there is some parameter that is put to zero. Could you find this parameter? Okay, if you don't know, let me tell you. So what are functions? Functions is something that take a point and bring it to, so in this case, to the homes. What is so specific here? And here mathematician, modern mathematician, not only modern, mathematician for the last 70 years should know that this is special because points is not a universal thing. More universal thing, so points belong to figures. They are particular case of figures. So this, by the way, was in the middle of the 20th century rethought by Grothendieck, who said that we will formulate algebraic geometry for figures. So he was talking about simple ideals. Ideals are not maximal ideals. It was understood in the same time when people introduced differential forms. And you can write about, read about it, say, in the old book of Arnold, Mathematical Methods of Classical Mechanics. So there are not only points, there are lines, there are surfaces, and the domain of the function should not be just points, but also lines and surfaces. And what would it mean? It means that we have understand functions as a particular case of differential forms on GOM. So here is democracy of figures. Differential forms may be understood as functions on figures. So if you have function, okay, so this is a name. And I am explaining to you the concept. And concept is more important than the name. If you have a function, if you have a point, there is evaluation map. We compute function at a point. If we have differential form, and if you have a figure, okay, so everybody here speak Russian, so I can use this Greek letter phi for figure. So what is the analog of evaluation map? The analog of evaluation map is the integral of omega over figure. So this is written in this way in the good old Arnold book. That's why this thing should be properly generalized to differential form, at least. So what is interesting about differential forms? One thing that is interesting about differential forms is that these differential forms are used everywhere in physics, starting from the middle of the last century. And actually, now the last generation of physicists, who do not feel what differential form is going to retirement. So I know physicists who cannot feel free in their operations with differential forms. So now everybody in physics knows about differential forms. So what is remarkable about these differential forms is that that these differential forms not only form a vector space, they form a complex. So differential form form a complex. So one second. You see, I need to check time because people who know me know that I can talk without stop. Okay? So it's a bad habit. So let us make a 10 minutes break or 5 minutes break. Okay, let us vote. So since you muted your voice, you can vote by raising hands. So one hand would mean 5 minutes break and two hands would mean 10 minutes break. Could you vote? Five, great. I also vote on five. You see, not like an American election. Still we have a 5 minutes break, yes? Saying something provocative, but I actually want questions. And the reason why I want questions is that I want to get a feedback.
Хорошо, извините, что на русском. Но я думаю, я... Что-что?
No problem.
Окей. Мне кажется, ну, те понятия из алгебры мне более-менее понятны. Вы сказали, что есть некий комплекс. Да? Это значит не просто какие-то векторные пространства, но и морфизмы. Такие, что там два последовательных, они действуют, ну, за нуля. Все.
Okay, so now we are coming to this. So this space of differential forms. So how to understand this space algebraically? Suppose you have axis. No, I need to change. Suppose I have xi's. Variables. Later on, I can think of them as a local coordinates. I will call them even. Suppose I have psi's. These are odd. What does it mean that variable is odd? So physicists know. And they commute with x. So let me consider function of x and psi that starts with omega naught of x. Let me put naught upstairs plus omega 1 I of x psi I. So here I'm writing something like Taylor series. Psi I, psi j. Plus, etc. This would be finite because the total number of psi's is finite and I need to have different psi's here. Then let me define very important notion, the Durham differential. That is psi I d over dx dxi. Then one can check that this object squares to zero, and also it is odd because these guys belong to differential forms, and Z2 degree, Z2 grading of omega is given by the number of psi's moduli 2. Even number of psi's or odd number of psi's. This thing changes the number of psi's, so it is odd. So this thing takes even differential forms into odd and vice versa. And it squares to zero. That's why these omegas actually form a complex. Then you may say that in mathematical literature, you never see notation like this. Let me give you equivalent notation. If I apply the Durham differential to xi, I get psi I. So if you put here instead of psi's dx's, you will get the familiar notation in all textbooks. What is important here? It's important that we consider the space of all forms simultaneously. we are not dividing them into graded components. Okay. So have I answered your question about why this is a complex?
I think yes, thank you.
Okay. Now, let me tell you that it's not the only complex that people have. Let me give you other examples of complexes that are met in so-called mathematical physics and even in theoretical physics. By the way, people call this odd operator that squares to zero differential because they borrowed the name from Durand differential. Because since Durand differential derives, it looks a bit like a difference. Now I'll propose another example of a complex, also very important. Consider odd variables CA. It's important that they are odd. Now consider operator Q. F, A, B, E, CA, CB, D over DCC. So this thing is anti-symmetric in this indices. So do you know what is equivalent to condition that Q squares to zero? Of course, this Q is acting on functions on C. Have you ever met with such an object? And what is the condition when this squares to zero? So let me ask you to guess. That if you square this object, you will get what? You will get some quadratic relation on this f's that are coefficient. And these f's are anti-symmetric in the A and B. So have you ever met such structure in your life?
Например, структурные константы, если я правильно понял, о чем речь, какой-нибудь алгебрилье.
Very good guess. Very good guess. This structure Q square equal to zero equivalent to the fact that F is a structure constant of Lie algebra. Okay, so if you don't know this, you may check this. So exercise, check it explicitly. And this differential already has a name. This is called Chevalier differential. I always forget how to write his name. So in order to hide my ignorance, you see, I studied it from Russian textbooks. So I put Chevalier. Now, let us play another game. Just imagine that we have representation of Lie algebra. So what does it mean? It means that we have space V and we have operators TA that acts from V to V such that TA TB commutator equals FABC BE, I put TE. You see, after Lie discovered Lie algebra, it was realized that the same structure could be represented, as people were saying in these days, by matrices. And the same algebra could be represented by matrices of the different size. So of course we know it when we have different representations, say of SO3. It's called the theory of momenta. It is studied in the course of quantum mechanics. So of course you met it. But I am not sure that you have met the following object. It also belongs to Chevalier. CA TA plus 1/2 FABE CA CB D over DCC. Exercise number 2. Check that this object squares to 0 and check this 1/2. So this acts, this is also called Q Chevalier, where on the space of functions of C, and here we have vector space V. So have you ever met this object? So I think Olga probably met this, but she is not with us at the moment. So I'm asking you, Eduard, have you met this object before? I mean this. So what is your department?
In Kyiv. Okay. Okay, Department of Theoretical Mathematical Physics.
Okay,
but I don't really know what
to say. Have you studied gauge theories?
Yes.
So this object was discovered by Chevalier in the 50s, and it was rediscovered in gauge theories in the 70s by physicists. It's called BRST. We can generalize further. So what are these linear, how to understand this linear operators? These linear operators could be understood in the original Sophus Lie way of thinking of Lie algebra. You know that Sophus Lie, when he discovered Lie algebra, he was not studying matrices or linear operators. He was studying vector fields. So, I will generalize the notion of representation of Lie algebra. So I will say, suppose we have a manifold Y and the set of vector fields VA of Y, and I put upper index. So not I, let me put here index M. And suppose that the Lie bracket of VA, VB, it's also called Lie bracket. It is this. So it is a bracket of the vector field. Sometimes people introduce this Lie derivative, this L is for Lie, and say that these two derivatives could commute. So commutator of these two operators may be the operator of the same type with some other vector field VC. So this is called also representation, but non-linear. Previous representation and operators were just linear operators, and this is non-linear operator. Then we can generalize and put here CA VAI of X D over DXI. And of course, there is summation over repeated indices. But this is not the end of the game. Let us see what is common in all examples that I have. All these differentials here are nothing but the first order differential operators. So here it has derivative in even coordinates. Here it has derivative in odd coordinates. However, there was a great mathematician called Grassmann who lived in the middle of the century before the last century, middle of 19th century. And he was not even a university professor. He was a school teacher. And he had several good ideas that were not properly understood by people who lived together with him, I mean, in the same time. First idea that he had is that you need to consider even variables and odd variables on the same footing. This came up as a mainstream only 100 years later in so-called super mathematics developed by Berezin and his school. And that is the way how I'd like to treat it. So before I'll treat it in the way like Grassmann would treat it, I just want to say that I have just recently realized that it was Grassmann who understood that if you have three numbers, it's a point of the three-dimensional space. If you have four numbers, it's a point of the four-dimensional space. In this way, Grassmann discovered what we are calling right now Rn, n-dimensional space. Now it's very obvious, and we may think why Dirac? Sorry, not Dirac. So, why Descartes? Why Descartes did not go up this? Now we understand this is a trivial idea. However, in the middle of the 19th century, people never thought about higher dimensional spaces. It's because we cannot imagine them. You see, now it seems very strange. Because they didn't even realize that time could be the fourth coordinate. So would they think that the time is a fourth coordinate, they would easily go further and imagine higher dimensional spaces. However, it was only Grassmann who did this. Okay, so now let us, he never got the professor position, okay? Because he was too deep to be understood by academia at that time. Okay, so now let us see how can we generalize this. Let us follow Grassmann and introduce variables ZA. These variables may be either even or odd. And let us write the general structure. VA of Z, D over DZA. Let us call it Q of V. And let us decompose it. So here we have what? Here we have VA B1, or just, yes, B1, Z B1, D over D ZA. So I'll expand in Z plus VA B1 B2, Z B1, Z B2, D over D ZA, plus VA B1, B2, B3, Z B1, Z B2, Z B3, D over D ZA. So have we ever met such things? So first term could be here if vector field is a constant. So why not to have a constant vector field or vector field that has constant term? This term partially is here and partially is here for linear vector field. This term typically is somewhere here, but we may generalize. So we have a set of objects VAB1, VA B1, B2, etc. We would like to consider them as an operations and condition that QV, I would like to put here a hat in order not to mix it with other V, squares to zero is a set of quadratic relations on these objects. Unfortunately, it's not our discovery. So would we be smart when Chevalier introduced this? Would we live in 50s? And would we remember Grassmann? We could write it very easily, and we would discover a new mathematical notion. However, this notion was discovered later. And this notion, I mean the set of these V's that satisfy these quadratic relations, is known with the name L infinity algebra. You may ask why L infinity? It's because this middle term looks like an operation. If there will be no other terms, this term in this field would be a Lie algebra. What infinity means? Infinity means that there are other operations. So this object, it has one input, one output. V, A, B1. V, two inputs, one output. Now something interesting comes. V A B1 B2 B3 etc. When I will differentiate, I will contract indices etc. It turns out that this contraction of indices and this quadratic equation could be depicted graphically. This sum, here are some complicated plus minus signs, equals to zero. So this is generalization of the Jacobi identity. Here there are some V's and here there are some V's. Let me show you how to write down in the graphical form Jacobi identity. One, two, three. Three inputs, one output. But we also have one, three, two. But we also have 2, 3, 1. We sum up these terms, say that it equals to zero, and this is Jacobi identity. From this point of view, let us consider the case where there are no higher terms. Not only no higher terms. Let us consider a case where there is one input and one output. Only one diagram. And this is a diagram that says that this matrix squares to zero. So in an infinity structure, this is a differential. Okay? Moreover, it is instructive to check the following term. Two inputs. Inputs 1, 2. There are also other diagrams. I'll write down all of them. 1, 2. And also, one, two, and out. And here are some signs. And this equation is Leibniz equation. It says that differential, people used to say, differentiates the binary product. By the way, it's interesting to know that Leibniz equation, or maybe it's better to call him Leibniz, was called Leibniz for a very curious reason. Because it was a long time ago when Newton was constructing analysis. And for Newton, okay, so it's a history, but it's important history. Okay, I'll erase this. So when Newton was discovering analysis, for him, it was very clear that Fg prime should be F prime G plus Fg prime. It's absolutely obvious. So nowadays we write it as dFg equals dFg plus Fdg. So von Newton it was obvious. However, Leibniz had a different idea. Original idea of Leibniz was that derivative acts like this. It was Leibniz idea. Okay? Newton told him that he is wrong. Leibniz inspected the question, realized that correct formula is like this. He became excited and he wrote a special paper explaining this. And now we call it Leibniz rule. So the moral out of this is that if you are making mistakes and you are trying to clear them out, it very well may be that your homework would bring you the world fame. Okay? So let me check what time is it now, because I should not speak more than, I should not speak more than 45 minutes. So do you have a question at the moment? Edward, so I see you, that's why I'm asking you.
Okay, maybe the general question.
Please.
Yes. Now we have a talk about some. We must now build in some way a theory about that higher topological quantum field theory that you say in the start, yes?
Yes.
And we, and now we.
What are we?
In the future, in the future, we must in the some way. This, ну, розвивати цю думку, якби, ну, про це, якби, про це була, як ти правильно розумію?
Що?
Якби, ну, це, от ви сказали про оцю, якби, ну, топологічна квантова теорія поля, це higher, да? Якби ми далі маємо розвивати, якби далі, якби рухатись, якби, в цей бік. Правильно я розумію? Якби, ну, для чого зараз вводяться, якби, ну, якби всі ці, якби, речі? Хотілося якось, можливо, да, можливо, я... Да.
Проблема. Я немножко понимаю по-українськи, но...
Ой, извиняюсь, ой, господи. Извиняюсь.
Украинский для меня
слово. Yes, извиняюсь, извиняюсь. Трудно просто переключиться было. Окей. Мы говорили об этой, ну, об топологической квантовой теории поля. Вначале вы сказали... И сейчас мы как бы будем развиваться, ну, как бы в направлении, как бы, ну, как бы в этом направлении, правильно понимаю, все эти конструкции?
Сейчас у нас будут дифференциалы разные.
Да, да, да. But, но и вначале у нас было как бы с теорией категорий,
да.
Ну, вы объясняли. И очень понятно, в общем, как это будет связано. Я, может, ты упустил это как-то?
No, I'll explain.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. It will be connected in the following way. So, to my understanding, the modification that we will do immediately will be the following. After I recall the idea of complex, I'll do the following replacement. So, vector spaces would be replaced by complexes. Okay? And here we have the fresh. So, complexes is a pair, VQ. And I assume that V is Z2 graded. Two is important. Some people in the literature use Z grading. We will use Z2. Function on geometric data would be replaced by differential form on geometric data. Okay? And now, the main object, I, that depends on cobordism sigma, geometric data G, and now since differential form, I will write it DG, or you may write it psi, it depends how you prefer to do it. Would belong to differential form on geometric data times HOM from some number of complexes.
Извините, только у меня доска маленькая. Я плохо вижу.
Now, what's important to see? That this is a complex with the action of the Durham differential. This is also a complex because because there is a Q acting here. I of course assume that Q of V1 tensor V2 is Q1 acting on V1 plus V1 tensor Q on V2. So now we have a possibility to act on this object with a total differential, because this is a complex. And now we add one more axiom. No, since it's very important axiom, I will write it in red. D total applied to I that is D on geom the RAM plus Q applied to I equals to zero. So this is the condition of closeness of functor. Okay. So all my speech is to add just one word to the definition of QFT. In words, I just want to say that higher T Q F T is a closed functor from cobordisms equipped with geometrical data and category of complexes. That's it. I could start with this definition, but then I'll have to explain things that are involved. So what we need to know from the first talk is this definition. And all the rest are examples. And let me conclude today's discussion by the simplest example of H, T, Q, F, T. It's called HTQM, prior topological quantum mechanics. So we have the main object I that depended on T and now DT. That belonged to the endomorphism of complexes. times differential forms on R plus. Now, condition is so it's conditioned to be a functor. And second condition is di plus q, in this case means commutator, equals to zero. So this is functor. And this is closed. Let me give you a universal solution. So these are axioms. We know how to solve first axiom. And let me give you solution to the pair of axioms. I of t dt equals where g square equals to zero. So this is a universal solution. This is HTQM, this one. Of course, G X from V to V. It's linear operator. Q also X from V to V. You see, all these fancy words end up in the simple formula. And then there are many examples of this, but I think that it's enough for today. But I'd like to answer questions. I'd like to get questions and answer questions. Здравствуйте, Коля.
Здрасте, здрасте. Проверка на местах.
Математическое КГБ, ФСБ, МОСАД.
Ну да.
Службы не дремлют.
МОСАД не дремлет. Мало ли тут. Я бы снимать. Ага.
Ольга, вы там уже заснули или нет? Или у вас дети?
Я сплю, да. Это сон.
Нет, тут просто дети.
Дети. Ну, видите, у нас проверка. Как народ понимает? Значит, вопросы есть? Дети плачут. Так что, значит, вопросы мне можно писать. Мою почту можно взять на сайте. Можно индивидуально поговорить. А вот теперь у меня просьба к Петру, не могли бы вы нажать на кнопку «Сохранить запись»?